All right, good evening, family and friends.
Good evening.
Good evening. So I know there's not many of us here tonight, but I know people are still making their way in. But anyways, before we get into our praise and worship, I'm going to humbly ask Sister Helen if she could lead us in a prayer. Let's pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we praise you for this wonderful day that you have given us. We praise you, Father, for bringing us back into your house of prayer so that we may worship you together. Father, bless us all as we sing praises to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please put your beautiful voices together as we sing our first hymn, number 8, Be Gathered Together.
Possibly can do to prepare a people for him to come and receive unto himself, that where he is, there we may be also. We started the series last week, Sunday. We had a wonderful message starting last week, Sunday, called Amazing Discoveries That Prove the Bible True. From there, we went to night number two, and we heard about the solution to the worldwide crisis. And then from there, we went on to night number three, and we talked about, if God was so good, why is there so much suffering? That was night number three. Night number four, we discussed about the coming of the King. That would be the second coming of Jesus Christ. And we learned about how there is no such thing as a secret rapture, that Jesus is going to come secretly and take people secretly, that his coming would be visible, audible, it would be loud. The Bible says every eye will see him. So we learned about that in night number four. Then we went to night number five, and we learned about Revelation's most amazing messages. We learned about the present truth messages for this time. As Noah preached a message at his time, for him, that was his present truth. And his message was, get into the ark, right? And did the people listen to Noah? No, they ended up rejecting his message, and only him and his family made it into the ark. Every story throughout the Bible in which God had a prophet, God had a messenger preaching a message for that time. And we asked the question, what's God's message for this time? And we discovered that in night number five in Revelation's most amazing messages, in the three angels' messages found in Revelation chapter 14. Night number six, we had a wonderful time talking about the most amazing Bible prophecy. We learned about the 2300 day prophecy and when the date that the Bible declared that the judgment of God began. We learned about how God was going to come back in Revelation. The Bible says that Jesus says, behold, I come quickly and my reward is with me. And we learned that if he came with a reward, that must mean there must have been some kind of investigative judgment done before to determine what reward everyone gets, right? So we learned that in night number six. And then, of course, yesterday, we learned about the good news about the judgment. We learned that the Father, our Heavenly Father, who loves us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but that same Father is our judge. And we also learned yesterday that his Son, Jesus Christ, would be our advocate or our lawyer. And we learned that the judgment was pretty much set up to our advantage to win through the blood of Jesus. That we would be declared not guilty, as Satan loves to say, no, we are guilty, right? We learned that yesterday. And now here tonight, today's message, buckle your seats. Sister Etz is going to give you a wonderful message tonight. It's called A Formula. A Formula for a Crime-Free Society. Have you noticed society nowadays? A lot of crime. The love of many grow cold, the Bible says. And we want to know, what is the solution or a formula for a crime-free society? That's what you're going to learn today. And so, with that being said, I would like to welcome each and every one of you, our regular church family, but especially each and every one of our visitors tonight. We thank you for making the decision to be here tonight. You could have been anywhere else on this island. You could have been home enjoying maybe a cup of tea or something, eating some masasenda. But you chose to put that aside because we're dealing with eternal issues here. We're dealing with issues between eternal life or eternal death. You decided to come to hear the words of Jesus. So we welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. Of course, our young people, thank you for being here tonight. And so, I'd like to remind you just one little bit of announcement before I sit down. We had a challenge that Elder Salu put on last week, and that was, come up with the hardest Bible question that you can possibly think of. Write it down, put it in our little question box in the back. If we determine that your question was the hardest Bible question possibly, we have a prize for you. At the end of our series, at the end of this week, which our series will come to end, we have a prize for you. If you can come up with the hardest Bible question that you possibly can, and through God's grace, we're going to answer it. Well, Brother Aaron's going to answer it for you. All right? So that's the challenge. Please, don't be afraid. If you have a question regarding our past presentation, tonight's presentation, the future presentations, or any Bible question you may have, please feel free to write it down, and we'll love to take that time to answer. Amen? All right, so we'll give it over to our Bible question time now to Brother Aaron, as we had a question from our previous presentation, and Brother Aaron will go ahead and answer that question now.
Thank you very much. Again, I love to see everybody here. I love Bible questions, Bible question time. We did have one question that came in, I believe it was Friday night. So here it goes. Is it allowed to divorce your husband or wife and get remarried or married again? When or while the husband or wife is still alive? Interesting question. So the answer is yes or no. It's situational or dependent upon the reason or matter of for the divorce. Whether the divorce was scripturally what? Legal or illegal, along with there's some other factors in there. So first, let me start by saying that both marriage and divorce, if someone's getting divorced, are very what? Solemn and serious matters. Not just divorce, but marriage itself. No one should do either without prayerfully considering God's will, which is found in Psalms 40, verse 8. I like to do thy will, my God, yea, thy law is within my heart. A marriage entered into without God's counsel or will being prayerfully considered is what? Very dangerous. You play with the eternal things there. And the same goes for divorce. Especially if what? Children of the marriage are involved. So you not only might destroy your life, the life of the husband or spouse, you might actually involve children in that. Secondly, Scripture gives only what? One valid reason for divorce. And even then with caution in the light of all avenues of what? Forgiveness, mediation, and reconciliation having been attempted and failed. By the way, you can read Hosea, the entire book, to find out more about Hosea and Gomer. The Bible says in Exodus 20, verse 14, thou shalt what? Not commit adultery. In Matthew 5, 32, here's the one and only reason given in the entire Bible. But I say unto you that what? Whosoever, that's me, you, anybody, shall put away his wife, that's a divorce, saving for, which means except for, what? The cause of fornication, cause of her to commit what? Notice the difference between fornication and adultery. Fornication is very specific. It doesn't say that you can divorce your wife for merely thinking about somebody else. It says it must be for fornication. It must be the physical act. So, and cause her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced, that is, except for that cause, so they divorce illegally, commits what? Adultery. So someone who divorces illegally, which means that clause was not fulfilled, they're committing what? Adultery. So I just want to make sure that is very clear. Now the body is not for fornication. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13. Please notice that Matthew 5:32 does not say what? Does not say that a person in a marriage relationship whose partner commits fornication must divorce. People read it that way. No. It says it's only a divorce in that single circumstance is legally what?
Allowable.
That's where forgiveness comes in. And reconciliation, if possible. Because God is in the business of forgiveness of sins, right? Mediation, right? So it's not a must, it is allowable. Notice this in Malachi 2:16, for the Lord, the God of Israel, said that he what? Hated putting away or hates divorce. He hates that. What therefore God hath joined together, let not what? Man put asunder. Don't let man divorce it. If God put it together, why is man messing with it? That's in Mark 10:9. Another reason that one possible exception to fornication given by Jesus in Matthew 3 is not legal, that is scriptural, grounds for divorce. Any such illegal divorce which takes place with persons marrying one another are committing what? Adultery with other persons. That's breaking God's, right? Is that clear? All right. Notice this in Mark 10:11. And he said to them, whosoever shall put away his wife and marries another, that's without the clause, right? There's no fornication involved. You're just divorcing for whatever reason. Doesn't matter. Commits adultery against her. And if a woman shall put away her husband and be married to another, that's without the clause, she commits adultery. Mark 10:12. So we got two for witness. We got Matthew saying it. We got Mark saying it. Clear?
Amen.
All right. And if the woman which hath a husband is bound by the law to her husband's, how long?
As long as he lives.
That's except for the clause in Matthew 5:32. Except the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. So what's one other example where a person is broken from marriage? If the other first person dies, right? That's Romans 7:2. 7:3 says, so then if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, that's without the clause, she be called an adulteress. But if the husband be dead, she is free from that law. So that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. But the question was dealing with living persons, right? But we're just going through a little bit of this. The wife is bound by the law as long as her husband liveth. But if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will. Only, notice this last part, by the way, only what? In the Lord. People think, well, I can get married to whoever. I can get married to a non-Christian. That's not what the Bible teaches at all. People think I can just get divorced and get married to whoever. No. Why? Because the married are no longer two flesh, but one flesh. So that means, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and they cleave unto his wife, and they shall be what? Genesis 2:24, also Ephesians 5:31. So to marry an illegally divorced person, that means there was no fornication involved, they just chose a reason, it is as if you are actually uniting with the flesh of the other half of the person you're now marrying. You catch that? That means if I, as a male, marry a woman who's divorced, but it was an illegal divorce, it's actually if I'm sleeping with her husband too. You catch that? Because they're one flesh. Right? If it's an illegal divorce, they're still one flesh in the eyes of God. Another situation that the scripture describes is that an unbeliever who abandons, notice the word abandons, leaves the married spouse in 1 Corinthians 7:10-16. So I'm going to read this one because people absolutely abuse this. I've even heard a pastor, a famous pastor, abuse that text right there. Notice what it says. And unto the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. Let not the wife, what? It doesn't say anything about divorce. It just says leave. Right? That's a separation. But, and if she departs, let her remain what? Unmarried. Or be reconciled to her. Notice, if she leaves, she still has a husband. Right? I've heard a pastor use this to say, well, she's divorced. No, that's not what that says. And let not the husband put away his wife, even if she leaves. But to the rest speak I, not the Lord. If any brother hath a wife that believeth not, right? A doubter, not a Christian. And she be pleased to dwell in, let him not put her away. You get into those marriages where one person's a Christian and the other person just happens to not be, or both were non-Christians and somebody, one of them, becomes a Christian. Well, he says, well, don't put them away if they're willing to live with you. Because God hates divorce, right? And the woman which hath a husband that believeth not, and if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. So it works both ways, male and female. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. It's because one is a Christian, so you're leading them closer and closer to Christ, hopefully, right? Else were your children unclean, but now they are holy. Don't abuse that. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart, let him leave. Because marriage is about love. It's not about forcing somebody to stay in. If both people were not Christians and somebody becomes a Christian, God doesn't say, okay, you have to stay with my marriage. Well, that's not what they bought into in the first place, right? One person becomes a Christian, the other person might say, no, I don't want that. They're free to go. But notice the stipulation. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases. They say, see, I can marry somebody else. No, that means you don't have to take care of them. Because as a husband, I'm supposed to support my wife and the children. But if she leaves on her own, she's on her own. This whole alimony stuff is foolishness. For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy husband? Or how knowest thou, O man, whether thou shalt save thy wife? Because when the Israel of old started fornicating and doing other things with other gods, God said, okay, you're on your own. Into Babylon. You didn't have to support them. Notice that in 1 Corinthians 7:10-16, the text speaks about what? Because of? By one spouse. That is not a valid legal, that's a scriptural, reason for divorce. The Bible only gave how many reasons? One reason. What was it? Fornication. So it's not legal to put away as is for fornication, no matter what a person, a pastor, well-known or not, says. You read that very carefully, 1 Corinthians 7:11, because it says, and if she depart, let her remain unmarried, or be reconciled to her husband. Again, that's because he still is her husband, whether she left or not. Persons abuse and rest that. It speaks, unbelief depart, let him depart. Brothers, sisters, not under bondage in such cases, and they use it wrongly to teach that if an unbelieving spouse departs from the marriage, then it's legally allowable for the believing party to marry another. Not so. That means they're actually committing adultery. unbelief and departure of one spouse is not legal grounds for the other partner to marry someone else. The two are still one flesh in the eyes of God and their vows. The only way for a person whose partner left them, they just got up and left through unbelief, to marry another is if, and only if, the unbelieving partner, while they left, does what? They commit fornication. But if they just left and they're single, they're still married. And even while the other person might be committed fornication, they're still married until divorce. So it's still fornication, or what? They die. So if the person leaves, the other person dies, then it's legal. Additional matters regarding marriage and divorce involve the office of the high priest. I found this one interesting. He shall take a wife in her virginity. A widow or divorced woman or profane or harlot, these shall he, that's the high priest, not take. But he shall take a virgin of his own people to wife. See, there's even restrictions on remarrying people in the Bible. How many knew that? Yeah. Therefore, a high priest could not just marry any person, not even legally divorced person. He had to take a virgin. Even a widower, he couldn't do it. But only a virgin of his own people. Which means that a high priest, if they had such a wife who committed fornication and ended up being legally divorced from her, could marry somebody else, but it was with what? Specifications. God is very clear. There are also rules for those who are just regular what? Priests. How many are kings and priests in this room? They shall not take a wife that is a whore, a profaner, neither shall they take a woman put away from her husband. Oops. For he is holy unto his God. There's a lot that the Bible says about marriage and divorce that we're not following as God's people. A priest of God could not marry a divorced woman, even if she was legally divorced and innocent of transgression. She could marry another, but not a priest of God. By the way, this also has implications from the natural as well as the spiritual. For a Christian is a king and priest unto God, 1 Peter 2:9, Revelation 14:1. Is that clear about the question about a yes or no, if a person could get divorced, whether the other husband or wife is still living? Yes? It's very clear. So those are the questions in the Bible's answer for tonight. Thank you. Bible study is our joy, and it is our pleasure to carry out its instructions. God bless you all, and now we have our health talk.
Welcome to tonight's edition of Spotlight on Health. Before we dive into our presentation, I'd like to ask the congregation to close your eyes. Close your eyes and bow your heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Father God in heaven, we thank you so much for bringing us today, despite the showers. I'd like to ask you, Father, to please open the minds and the hearts of your people so that your health message may flow in and through them, and that we may live by it. We ask that you please be with us for the remaining hours of tonight. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. All right, coming to church today, what did you notice outside? Heavy showers of rain, right? It kind of reminds you of the days of Noah. These heavy rains, what happened to the people when the rain started drizzling? I mean, it hasn't rained for a lot of years, and what happened? What do you think happened when it started raining? Don't you think some people started running to the ark? Well, with all that rain out, I'd like to thank you guys so much for being in the house of the Lord, or should I say the Lord's ark today. Our presentation is on none other than air. Sometimes we might overlook the importance of air. Yeah, but what do you think happened to the people during the times of Noah? Lack of air, right? So air might be so important. Well, one, air keeps us alive. Two, air conditioning. A breath of fresh air. Could we please read the text that's on the board? So we have to have a healthy what? Physical being and a healthy what? Healthy soul, right? It goes 2-1-2. Now if you look at this picture, what's significant about this picture? Dry, right? Lack of what? Lack of water. Do you see any life? Do you see any food right next to the woman? No, right? But what is there? What's keeping her alive? Air, right? So even though we might not have water, we might not have food, but we can survive because we have air. You can survive without air for You can survive without food for what? For weeks, water for days, but yet air? Without air, you would die in what? Minutes, right? It doesn't say hours, it doesn't say days. Like right when you go, like lack of air, you die. Air starvation is much more deadly than food starvation. Lack of oxygen in the brain for 5 to 10 minutes results in permanent what?
Brain
damage, right? And without our brain, what can we do? Basically nothing, right? So if we don't have air for 5 to 10 minutes, brain damage. The benefits of fresh air. It improves the brain's ability to function, giving clarity to the mind while improving concentration and boosts learning abilities. So kids, if you want to be smart, you breathe, right? Make sure you have enough of air in your system. This is a picture of a healthy brain that has enough oxygen. It gives a sense of happiness and well-being by altering brain levels of hormone serotonin. Now, hormone serotonin is a chemical in your brain that is quite very important. Now, this is a picture of an individual with a happy brain. So, like, enough air in your system makes you happy and gives you a very strong brain. It promotes quality sleep. What's so significant about this picture? She's in a very deep sleep. And why do you think she's in a very deep sleep? If you notice the grass around her, it provides fresh air for her to sleep. And I'm pretty sure if we sleep in a little closed off room, we won't have good sleep, right? So if we sleep with fresh air, it promotes the quality of our sleep. Kills bacteria and viruses in the air. So fresh air, if you notice on the picture, the air that we breathe on a daily basis, it might have a lot of toxins and a lot of viruses in the air, but we may not know that. That's why we have to promote the breathing of fresh air. So if you might think that the air that you're breathing has a lot of toxins in it, try to move somewhere else where you get fresh air. It boosts immune functions. So like your immune system, for those of you who don't know what the immune system is, this is a system that serves as a shield. As you see all the toxins and all the viruses and the diseases hitting the shield. So like if you have enough fresh air in your system, this will like boost up your immune system. It'll help fight away all the diseases that'll try to attack your body. Air pollution or unclean air causes the loss of many of these benefits. So all the benefits that we... Alright, so all the benefits that we just talked about, without fresh air, if we lack fresh, clean air, none of these benefits will help us. So air pollution, these are some examples of air pollution. As you know, you can see cancer. Well, if air pollution causes cancer, and where do we get this air pollution from? From all the factories and the car emissions, you know. That's why we gotta promote healthier lifestyles and healthier living. Breathing, when sick, releases toxins and poisons from the body. So if you're sick, try to cover your mouth when you cough, or like, we call it the Dracula sneeze, where you sneeze into your elbow. It really helps a lot, you know, letting you spread these germs to your brothers and your sisters. If poisons remain and circulate in the room without fresh air, the person will take longer to recover. If you look at this picture, what do you notice about this room? It's dark and I can like see it's dirty, really dusty, dank. So if you're sick and you're on the verge of recovery and you stay in this room to try and recover, it'll be impossible for you to recover, and like said in this point, it will take longer for your recovery. If a wound is not exposed to fresh air, it will take longer to heal. Notice this picture. This point could also, say you have a wound on your body, right? If your wound is not exposed to fresh air, it'll take longer to heal, as the point said. But I like to think some of us might be emotionally wounded. And if you look at the picture, she's open to fresh air. Well, this doesn't mean literal fresh air. You can like receive fresh air from a brother or sister or a pastor. Like if you're having problems in your life, talking to such individuals will help you bring in that fresh air, not little fresh air, but fresh air that'll help your soul. So as you can see in the picture, all the trees and the mountains, the abundant of life. Take time to breathe deeply. I know this might sound silly, but who here does not know how to breathe? All right, so if you don't know how to breathe, you're going to learn tonight. Try taking a deep breath, breathing in and breathing out. Does that feel good? Okay, breathe. Breathing is such a beautiful thing. We might tend to overlook the importance of breathing, but it's such a beautiful thing. Make sure rooms are well ventilated, air is circulating in the room, wind is allowed to flow inside the room. Well, the house of the Lord, we have air conditioning, but if you're at home and you try to lock up, like if you lock all your windows, what'll happen? You start sweating and then you start to suffocate, right? That's why it's important to have a well-ventilated room and that air is circulating inside the room. As you can see in the example here, this is an example of a ventilated room. Spend time outside. Go for walks outdoors and plant a garden. Well, don't stay at home. I know we have Wi-Fi at home, but go outside, you know, walk around. Appreciate God's creation, and none other than that, go improve his creation, you know, plant your gardens, you know, plant food for your family. Spend time outside. And then point number three, take more activities outside, meetings, gatherings, picnics. This kid, what's happening to this kid? He's running, right? And what's around him? Grass, the sky, trees. Such so much life in this picture. Not only the kid, but the grass, the trees, and also in the sky. Why? Because all around him is fresh air. And that concludes our presentation today. If you have any other questions, please visit our website at scamaranathachurch.org. And there you will, all your questions will be answered. Thank you so much for listening to our Spotlight to Help today. Thank you.
Thank you.
When the water is clear.
Society, a formula for a crime-free society. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, here we are again. To thank you and to praise you for the many blessings that you have blessed us with. Now we are ready to hear your message, Lord. We ask you to please open our hearts and our mind so we can be able to understand a message that you are trying to teach us this wonderful evening. Be with us, Father. Use me as your instrument and continue your Holy Spirit so I can be able to share your message according to your will. In this we ask and pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Amen. A crime-free society. The nice thing about crime, someone said, is that it usually happened to someone else. Maybe Dr. Eleanor Banks of Chicago felt that way until she was shot in the leg as she tried to beat off two armed assailants with her purse. Possibly that view was held by Walter and Mabel Nelson of Michigan until a gang broke into their home one night, tied them up, and drove off in their automobile. Unpleasant as the thought may be, crime is out of control. No longer can we sigh pathetically and blithely shrug our shoulders and say that crime is something that happens to someone else. Every time the clock ticks, another crime has been committed. Crime and violence are steadily creeping throughout the world, and some night soon, who knows, it may stop your darkened hallway. Statistics show that we stand better than one chance in four becoming a victim of robbery, rape, break and entering, embezzlement, or some other crime. Riots, political assassination, hijacking, murders, terrorist kidnappings, and government corruption shock the world. Beginning in the 70s, a new morality and situation ethics were illegitimately born. It was a time that came to mean do your own thing. And that could mean anything from smoking pot to streaking naked in public places or aborting an unwanted baby. It was time when neon sign bluntly beckons the man on the street to topless bars and porno movies. When gays and lesbians came out of the closet and living roommates unabashedly proclaimed their status. The 70s were shocking, but now, the 21st centuries, millions have never known any different. And that behavior doesn't shock the world anymore. It's becoming commonplace. Many authorities believe that the soaring crime rate and immorality found in the society today are ugly products of the pernicious teachings and moral current of our government, home, schools, and even churches. From the home, a new generation of pained children have emerged who are questioning, skeptical, and challenging. Children love to imitate, and yet, who are to be their ethical, moral, and spiritual role models? Father lies to the government, mother seeks abortions, and both parents cheat on each other. The children see it all, and the broken homes are living under scars. Who is to instill a sense of right and wrong in parents cannot or will not. Surely parents cannot leave so great a responsibility to the schools. But the question we must ask, who is to determine when a situation is right? Is not the judgment or even good people often impaired at times? If there is no standard of right and wrong outside of ourselves, we can justify almost anything. We may steal to support a bad habit, commit adultery if we are attracted to someone or shoot someone we dislike. The Bible reminds us we are not good judges of what is right and what is wrong. When it says in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 25, there is a way that seems right to a man, but it ends in the way of death. Even the churches are teaching that God's standard of right and wrong, his commandment, has been abolished. Or they are no longer relevant. Or they are impossible to keep. As a result, many people are following their own desires, doing their own thing, and society is reaping a bumper harvest of broken homes, juvenile delinquency, and violent crimes. The Bible says in Hosea chapter 8, verse 7, they sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. Yes, sad to say, we are discovering we do not get freedom by throwing out the rules. Remove the standard of right and wrong, and chaos follows. Ronald R. Hagstead, former editor of Liberty magazine, wrote, 20 centuries ago, the Apostle Paul wrote a crime report directed to the Christian church in Rome, a city where dissipation, crime, and moral rot were foreshadowing. Decline of the empire, the apostle laid it on the line. In Romans 1:28, can we all take part in this together, please? 2, 3.
Blessed because they have not seen fit to acknowledge God, he has given them up to their own way of reason. It is easy to break all rules of conduct.
A long time ago, God gave a formula for a crime-free society. And had it always been followed, crime would never have existed. Everyone would be safe and happy any place on earth. When the children of Israel camped at Mount Sinai, the Lord came down to meet them and said, in Exodus 22, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. First, the Lord identifies himself as the deliverer from slavery. He was the one who had opened up the Red Sea before them. He was their protector. In other words, he was saying, I care for you, you trust me. Then he spoke his divine law so men could know how to live in peace and safety, so men would know what was right and what was wrong. God spoke these words in Exodus chapter 20, verses 3 to 17. I would like us to take part in this together. 2, 3.
You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself a carved image. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet.
As Israel listened, they were greatly moved. If that was God's will, they determined to do it. But then, knowing how forgetful we human can be, and not wanting to trust exact wording to a frail memory of man, God wrote it all in a 2-tablet of stone with his own finger. As we read in Exodus chapter 31, verse 18, and when he had made an end of speaking with him on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses 2 tablets of the testimony, tablets of stone written with the finger of God. Amen? Even though this was the first time that God had given his law in written form, it has existed from all eternity. Long before Sinai, or even Adam and Eve, the eternal, unchangeable standard of right has been the basis of God's heavenly garment. the angels were governed by it. They could choose to follow God's law or choose to ignore it and rebel against it. Satan and his angels choose to do their own thing, make their own rules, and this rebellion led to their expulsion from heaven. But there were angels who choose to follow God and remain loyal to his law. As we read in Psalms chapter 103, verse 20, "Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word." Adam and Eve had a knowledge of God's law in Eden, for they felt the emotions of shame and guilt after wrongdoing. They recognized they had disobeyed God by taking something that did not belong to them and by choosing to follow another God. When Cain became angry because God accepted Abel's offering and not his, the Lord asked him in Genesis chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, "Why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door." God's law had to be in effect at the time, for we are told in Romans chapter 4, verse 15. Can we read this together, please?
"When there is no law, there is no transgression."
And even according to Todd Webster and New 21st Dictionary, 1992 edition, we read, "Transgression is the breaking or violation of law." Abraham knew and obeyed the law of God long before the spoken law at Sinai. God said he would bless Abraham and his descendants. For we read in Genesis chapter 26, verse 5, that Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments and my statutes and my law. After the Exodus, just a few weeks before Israelites reached Sinai, the Lord rebuked Moses because the Israelites were violating his law by gathering manna on the Sabbath. Let's read together Exodus 16, 28 and 32-33.
"And the Lord said to Moses, how long do you refuse to keep my commandments and my laws? So the people rested on the seventh day."
So you see, friends and families, the fourth commandment was recognized before Sinai. Yes, God's law is the eternal standard of right for the universe. And really, it should surprise us that God has a law governing his kingdom. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 33 and 14, "For God is not the author of confusion. Let all things be done decently and in order." There can be no orderly government without laws, no harmonious, happy, safe society without rules. Nature itself has laws. Even children cannot play games without rules. In the chamber of Supreme Court of the United States, towering above the head of the justice, appear two great figures carved in stone. One represents majesty of government and the other majesty of law. And between the two appear a tablet of the two tablets of the Ten Commandments. But impressive as this may be, commandment etched in stone and attached to the chamber walls are not enough. The Bible says in Romans chapter 2, verse 13, "For not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified." You see, not only it is important to know the commandment of God, we must also respond. Jesus said in John 14, 15, "If you love me, keep my commandments." In fact, Jesus quoted from the Old Testament, pointing out that love is the basis of keeping all commandments, when he said in Matthew 22, verses 37 to 40, can we read this together, please?
"You shall love the Lord your God with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets."
all our heart, mind, and soul, we certainly will express the love by keeping the commandments. It has been estimated more than 36 million laws have been drafted by men to control behavior. But in just 297 words, God drafted a code of conduct that in essence cover all the human behaviors. What a God.
Yeah.
But more importantly, unlike the defective or unwise law that men make and remake, the law of the Lord is perfect, as it says in Psalms 19, verse 7. Theologian Augustine Strong wrote, "Law is only the transcript of God's nature," God's character. "A character that is unchangeable, as written in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, for I am the Lord, and I do not change." You see, friends and families, any change in the law of God will make it less than perfect. Being a perfect law, it can never be altered. That the truth Jesus spoke when he said in Luke chapter 16, verse 17, can we all read it together, please?
"And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one tittle of the law to fail."
But you say, "I've always felt the Ten Commandments restricted my happiness, sort of fenced me in. God never meant his law to be a burden to men or restrict his happiness. On the contrary, God intended them to be a wall of protection, shielding us from sorrow and guilt. He intended that his law would ensure everyone's freedom and safety everywhere. In fact, God said in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 29, "Oh, that they had such a heart in them that they would fear me and always keep all my commandments. That it might be well with them
and with their children forever."
Just like we built a guardrail on the bridge, on bridges and mountain roads, from plunging off the road, God gave us his law to protect and guard us on the road of life. But there is another reason God gave man his law, as we read in Romans chapter 3, verse 20. "For by the law is the knowledge of sin." In fact, Paul says in Romans chapter 7, verse 7, can we read this together, please?
"I would not know sin except through the law.
For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, 'You shall not covet.'" Dr. Arthur Beards tells of an African princess who had been led to believe by her subject that her beauty was unsurpassed. However, one day a trader came to her village and sold her a mirror, something that did not exist in her land. When she looked into a mirror, she was so horrified by her ugliness and smashed the mirror in pieces. God's law is like a mirror. As we look into it, just like an African princess, we may not be pleased with what we see, for the law points out sin in our life. Destroying the law or ignoring it will not change our condition. The imperfection is still there. That is what James meant when he wrote in James chapter 1, verses 23 to 25. Can we please read this together? 2, 3. "For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this one will be blessed in what he does." Amen?
Amen.
The law points out sin, but no amount of good things we do in the future will erase the sin committed in the past. You see, friends and families, the law cannot atone for man's sin. It cannot save. The Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, verse 21, "For if there had been a law given which could have given life, truly righteousness would have been by the law." It is not the law that brings forgiveness and salvation. It is God's grace. Only through Christ's sacrifice can men have eternal life. In Romans chapter 6, verse 23, we read together 2-3.
"For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord."
Eternal life is a gift of God. Even if I kept the law perfectly from this day forward, the sin I have already committed condemned me to eternal death. Jesus had to pay the price of my sin on Calvary's cross. And only by his grace can my sin be forgiven. Now that I have accepted him and his grace, I will obey him. That obedience is the evidence of whether I really love him, whether my faith is genuine, and whether my heart is changed, whether I am born again. That's clear enough, isn't it? Please, mark this down in your memory and never forget it. We cannot be saved by good works, but God's work are the fruitage of salvation. Salvation always has been and always will be by grace. Men have always, in all ages, been saved by grace through faith. Perhaps this can best be illustrated by a story of a young man who killed someone in a fit of anger. He was apprehended and taken to prison. As he contemplated what he had done, he recognized he has broken the law. He felt a surge of guilt and sorrow. He was sentenced to die, but before execution, the warden came and handed him a pardon, which reads, "Pardon by the grace of Governor Brown." Tell me, does this mean that the prisoner is now free to live a lawless life? Do his own thing? Not at all, because he was pardoned by a gracious governor. A young man should feel more than ever his obligation to uphold the law of the land. Most importantly, God's law points out our sins and helps us feel the need of a Savior. As we accept Christ as our Savior, he provides forgiveness and also the power to keep his commandment. For he promised in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10, can we read this together, please? "I will put my laws in their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Amen? It is easy to do something you love to do, isn't it? And that is what the Lord promised to those who choose to follow him. He will write his law in their hearts, so they will love to do it. That is the only way men will be able to obey and follow God. It was because of his love for his Father that Christ was able to keep the commandments. In John 15:10, we read, "I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." And Jesus asked us to show our love to him by keeping his commandments. As we read in John chapter 14, verse 15, "If you love me, keep my commandments." The greatest demonstration of love and obedience to the will of God was vividly portrayed on a cold, dark night under the old olive tree in a garden, with drops of blood coursing down his face. The Son of God prayed in Matthew chapter 26, 39, "O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." The fate of the human race hung in the balance. A guilty world was to be saved or lost. Would this young Galilean put all desire for life and human fulfillment aside to die at Calvary? He would wipe the sweat from his brow and say, let the sinners suffer the consequence of their own sins. Or he would let wicked men nail him to the cross so men could be pardoned. In that awful crisis, when everything was at stake, Jesus dipped his pen of love in the crimson red ink, drained from his own vein, and wrote pardon across your record of mine. The old rugged cross on the hill of Mount Calvary was an eternal memorial of the price God was willing to pay to satisfy the claims of the broken law and to save guilty men. And friends, if the law could have been abolished or changed, Jesus' death on Calvary would have been unnecessary. Yes, he gave his son to die on the cross, and we are told in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, but with his own blood he obtained eternal redemption for us. That is what happened on a hill called Mount Calvary. Thank you.
please help us to be abide by your word. Help us to love you more, Lord, so we can also belong to a place that you have prepared for your people. We ask you to be with us tonight and continue to be with us as we go home, Lord. And please protect us and guide us as we go. May your travel mercies travel along with us and help us to understand your word and come back here tomorrow to hear more about you. And in this we ask in Jesus' mighty name, and we see. Amen.
What do you say, church? Amen? Amen. God's formula for a crime-free society is none other than his Ten Commandments, his law. I was listening to the presentation tonight, and I couldn't help but remember the story of Mary Magdalene, the woman that was caught in adultery. Remember that story? The Pharisees brought her in. They were ready to stone her because she was caught in adultery. But they wanted to bring her to Jesus and say, Jesus, Moses said, stone her. What do you say? Well, we know the story. Jesus bent down and he wrote the sins of the Pharisees in the ground. And then he said what? He that has no sin, cast the first stone. You see, she, according to the law of Moses, should have been stoned. But because Jesus stepped in and he saved her, and he didn't have to, but he saved her by grace. And after he saved her from being stoned, he said, woman, where are those who condemn you? She says, they're not here. And Jesus says, neither do I condemn you. Then he says a very important phrase. He says, go and sin no more. You know that if you go and sin no more, that means go and keep God's commandments. So now we know the basis of keeping God's commandments. It's based on because he saved us by grace, and so we respond to that grace by keeping his commandments. Not because we're trying to earn salvation, but because we have it through him. And so with that thought being said, I hope and pray that each and every one of you were blessed with the message tonight. And don't forget, tomorrow we have another very important topic. In fact, it's called God's Sign of Hope. God's Sign of Hope. This is regarding God's seal. And if you want to know about God's seal and what God's seal is, you want to come tomorrow. You don't want to miss. We begin song service at 6:45, then right at 7, our program starts. God is a God of time, so we must be on time as well. Amen? We don't want to keep God waiting. Let everything else wait. But let God be, let God see that we're here on time to hear his words of life. All right, so last announcement before you leave, please leave a question with us in the back. If you have a question, if you've been pressed, something that you're curious about, please feel free to leave that question back as you dismiss tonight. Have a good night, and we'll see you tomorrow by God's grace. Oh, yes, we have refreshments tonight. So if you find a rush, just grab a bag to go and enjoy it.